how do you map the internet? Actually, though, how do you personally draw a map of the internet? You may already have an idea, a technical diagram, or an image you saw once in passing. There may be bubbles, wires, multicolored connections, or maybe even just a grid of your favorite applications. Indeed, there's no definitive map of the internet. Every map keeps some things in, leaves some stuff out, and all are influenced by the progression of the internet as a technological, economic, and cultural force. We will trace through the history of internet maps with plenty of examples to understand the evolution of different approaches and views. By the end, even if you don't have a favorite map, you'll at least have some options. If I were asked to draw the internet, I would reproduce the image I've seen in computer networking class. This one comes from the textbook Computer Networking, 6th edition, by Kuros and Ross. It conveys many fundamental aspects. The connectedness of computers which have diverse forms and roles, and the inclusion of intermediate routers which direct traffic on redundant connections over a network. This is a logical diagram, an abstract representation that conveys important structural aspects of the internet while being very different from the actual physical layout of wire connections. I prioritize this conceptualization not because I want to posit that it's the right representation to which all others should be measured. Still, it appears in textbooks for a reason. One aspect of diagrams we will evaluate is their accuracy in portraying the structure of the internet, and this diagram provides a baseline when we compare later maps in their logical or physical linkages. This modern diagram is also presented because it is very similar to the diagrams of ARPANET in the 1970s. This network was a technical predecessor to the internet, and later was the first network to implement TCP/IP, the protocol used today by computers to communicate over a network. This logical map from 1973 represented the physical connections of a nascent internet network. Boxes labeled with their physical location and TIP or IMP represent what are now called routers, showing the available paths between end hosts, which were mostly universities. These are not just the earliest maps of the internet, but the earliest possible. The ARPANET maps are highly technical, created as reference documents at the cutting edge of network innovation. Maps in two styles were created as the network expanded from 1969 to 1990. The first, the logical map seen above, emphasized the logical pathways to clearly represent the order of connections. The second, overlaid on geography with magnification and critical areas, better situates the map in the real world. Our next map from this early period is not of the internet, but a diagram that helped create the conditions for it to succeed. In 1989, Tim Berners-Lee was an engineer at particle physics lab CERN and conceived of a paradigm to help organize information. He took the concept of hypertext, which are documents with live links to other documents, and proposed hosting it on the internet to create an updatable, interconnected web of notes. The visualization he provided is quite dense, but critically focused on laying out information and its relationships. This laid the groundwork for the World Wide Web, which propelled the adoption of the internet since people are primarily concerned with accessing useful information in an intuitive way, which hypertext provided. This will also be a recurring theme in other maps of the internet. Berners-Lee knew that he was proposing an application, a system built on top of but distinct from the internet. However, we will see many maps that show the parts of the internet that are used versus the invisible physical connections that these applications rely on. With the public release and adoption of the World Wide Web, usage of the internet increased exponentially from 1990 to 2010, in a period I see as the peak of internet mapping. This period intersected interest in the internet with a sense that it was still a novel thing not yet taken for granted, leading to significant effort in selling, understanding, and exploring this new thing. Martin Dodge's 2008 thesis, Understanding Cyberspace Cartographies, a Critical Analysis of Internet Infrastructure Mapping, contributes a lot to my analysis and shows significant insight and foresight. Many maps were created by infrastructure companies to sell the internet, and Dodge thoroughly cataloged maps advertising physical internet backbones. These were presented geographically to demonstrate the span and sophistication of their operations. These maps use historical convention to contextualize the developing technology. Dodge compares them to maps showing telephone communications, which are also intangible in its everyday operation. Producing maps with labeled nodes and connections makes this service seem like a more concrete thing to invest in. Overlaying the network maps over geographic space also appealed to expansionist tendencies of conquering space, and implied economic potential through the scale, number, and interconnectedness of its relations. Other artistic or academic maps from this era go beyond a single company and chart the vastness of the internet by attempting to graph the routes that actual internet messages would take through different ISPs. An early example was created in the late 90s by William Cheswick and Hal Birch at Bell Labs, which colored ISPs and had nodes that represented intermediate router hosts. A similar approach was used by two later projects. The OPTE project by Barrett Lyon was first published in 2003 and later updated and animated to show the growth of the internet through 2021. Meanwhile, CADA, an internet research institute at UCSD, has been updating a map since 2000. These use data from BGP, or Border Gateway Protocol entries for broad structure. BGP is the highest level of networking, a routing protocol that coordinates autonomous systems. AESs are networks considered distinct for routing purposes and are managed by a single organization, whether that's an ISP or a large company's private network. Finer-grained connections are provided with traceroutes, which indicate specific paths between individual routers, both within and between AESs. These maps have several interesting qualities. To me, they attempt to convey amazement at the expansiveness of the internet, and that simply tracing the public links between hosts and adding basic color coding could produce maps that are mystifying, while also giving useful insights into the topology of the web. For example, in both these graphs, we understand that there are a few extremely large and highly connected nodes with successively increasing numbers of AESs that primarily serve fewer local connections. These maps also imply physical links of the internet on a much finer scale than those overlaid onto geographical maps. By focusing on just the linkages between networks, we can see how rich their interconnections are. At the same time, emergent patterns also reveal political realities. Much of the structural pattern of the internet reflected in these maps follows the division of the world into countries. The OPTE project emphasizes their maps reflects even specific national circumstances, such as the bottleneck of entry points into the Chinese internet through state-owned ISPs, and the Iranian government's 2019 internet blackout in the animated graph. The marketing and route maps crucially demonstrate the growth of the internet during this lively period. Of course, it was not growing for its own sake, but to fill the demand for web traffic. An effort branded simply the Internet Map presents a 2011 snapshot of websites grouped together by proximity based on their connections through hyperlinks and whether they are visited together. This map is very different from many that we have seen because it doesn't imply physical linkages. Websites that link to each other don't connect through physical infrastructure, but rather through their content. This concept of evaluating websites based on their content connections is particularly interesting because it's similar to how Google and other ad-driven software companies see the internet. The PageRank algorithm at the heart of Google search considers websites important based on being linked to from other sites, especially other important sites, building a graph that is structurally similar to the internet map. This view, that prioritizes the perceived click value of websites, has become widespread due to its economic potential and is part of a trend of the increasing dominance of software and internet applications over hardware in defining the economic and societal impact of the internet. As part of this increasing significance, we can trace the emergence of cultural communities online. The geek culture of the internet is nearly as foundational as the early protocols that defined it. Science fiction fans with overlapping interests in technologies were early adopters of the internet, and one of the earliest email threads on ARPANET was dedicated to discussing science fiction. XKCD was a highly influential webcomic with great appeal to geeks, and a logical continuation of self-published sci-fi fanzines, which readily adapted to distribution and presentation in digital form. It was a diverse mix of sarcastic quips, oblique views of academic and technical life, visualizations and explainers, and one-off jokes. It was truly a comic native to the web, creatively using aspects of the web browser frame as part of its presentation. Scrolling wasn't simply a way to just go up and down, but a mode of interactivity that can only be expressed on a computer. With its important voice in originating a distinct internet culture, analyzing early XKCD comics featuring maps of the internet can illuminate how this culture was evolving. The first map is from 2006, comic number 195, Map of the Internet. This was technical, explaining how the IPv4 address space is allocated between different organizations, fitting the genre of XKCD posts that provides a novel visualization of a scientific concept, appealing to the curiosity of its scientifically minded audience. To an extent, this video itself could be related to XKCD comics such as this one, that sought to entertain and explain with a creative visual element to guide comprehension. The next two are from 2007 and 2010, in a series Online Communities 1 and 2. These are memorable depictions of websites as countries in a fantasy-style map. As the only methodology is that each nation roughly corresponds to its user base, these discard all pretense of physical or logical structure. On the surface level, this is a parody of the Atlas and fantasy books, and certainly is very fun to look at and read, even if completely imaginary. However, one soon realizes that these do have meaning beyond entertainment, as cultural maps of the internet. These maps emphasize the explosion of diverse forms of participation and engagement, and the communities that are forming online. We see Second Life and Friendster, with websites for banks or universities completely absent. There is implicit meaning too. The map reinforces the frame of national boundaries, implying power politics and competition between websites by portraying them as nation-states or kingdoms. This is similar to some marketing maps, which Dodge describes as pseudo-militaristic by associating the expansion of a network and the conquering of territory. Another map is more explicit, representing the count of each country's internet user base by scaling the size of the country, with the national flag overlaid. The contrast between the cheerful depiction of internet communities on one hand, but the hidden meaning of political conflict on the other, has foreshadowed the foiled utopian ideal of this era of the internet. It was easy to be lured by the promise of the internet to make information publicly available and free, economically and politically, with only minor frustrations and a little internet toxicity standing in the way. Despite the tremendous benefits of the internet in these areas, it has never been free from offline social, political, and economic relations. The imagination of internet communities as peaceful social groups belied analogous territorial disputes in the years to come about what the internet would be for whom, and to what purpose. Moving towards the present, maps of the internet have become increasingly sparse through the 2010s, as the internet has firmly become part of the everyday. Dodge predicted this well from 2008. The infrastructure is too invisible and naturalized, with widely available mobile data connecting end devices without any physical sensation. With the physical network well built out, software is now where money is to be made, changing the language of maps. Cloud computing providers boast about their global availability, but unlike the marketing maps of the 1990s and 2000s, which were conceptually similar, these modern maps often have no connections drawn between their data centers. It is simply understood that these sites are deeply connected, with unlimited bandwidth made available from the cloud provider, if the budget permits. Of course, the physical infrastructure is still fundamental. However, these have become the domain of networking specialists. Most of us become cognizant of the mechanics of the internet only through dramatic disruptions to everyday functioning. For example, some might remember the 2021 global Facebook outage, which took down all Facebook services everywhere for over 5 hours. We can explain the outage using maps to show how the modern software age has both occluded but still fundamentally relies on what we've seen. We will trace Facebook's outage report on our original diagram of the internet. This outage was triggered by the system that manages our global backbone network capacity. The backbone is the network Facebook has built to connect all our computing facilities together. This outage is interesting because it takes place fully within Facebook's private network. A key reality to clarify is that companies like Facebook have private networks not located all in one place like this image implies. Rather, these hyperscaler companies will build or lease exclusive use of physical interconnections to build a private network spanning the whole globe, in a parallel system that much resembles the public internet network. Therefore, we could imagine that this private network bubble is actually overlaid over the rest of the internet, since the physical connections can be shared, but we separate it to reflect the logical separation of its traffic. Those data centers come in different forms. Some are massive buildings that house millions of machines that store data and run the heavy computational loads that keep our platforms running, and others are smaller facilities that connect our backbone network to the broader internet and the people using our platforms. When you open one of our apps and load up your feeder messages, the app's request for data travels from your device to the nearest facility, which then communicates directly over our backbone network to a larger data center. Another place our graphic is misleading. The second sentence describes what's called an edge server, a router at the edge of a private network that is an intermediary between public and private traffic. This graphic implies that visiting a website is a long hop to an edge router, followed by a short hop from the edge router to a web server. This is not necessarily the case. Large internet companies will have many edge locations to eagerly accept public traffic and forward their requests efficiently on the private network. In an extreme case, you might be living in the US and request a video Facebook has only stored in Mongolia. Your request will only be on the public network long enough to be picked up by a Facebook router, maybe even in your own city, and the rest of the connection to Mongolia would be on Facebook's private network. Distances and sizes in this chart are not proportional. This was the source of yesterday's outage. A command took down all the connections in our backbone network, effectively disconnecting Facebook data centers globally. In our visualization, these connections between the Facebook routers, which we're understanding to be distinct data centers, were cut. Users could still reach Facebook Edge servers, but there was no way to forward those messages to serve their request. The Edge router couldn't connect to Facebook Mongolia. And that total loss of connection caused a second issue that made things worse. In the recent outage, the entire backbone was removed from operation, making these locations declare themselves unhealthy and withdraw those BGP advertisements. The end result was that our DNS servers became unreachable even though they were still operational. This made it impossible for the rest of the internet to find our servers. This is why the outage was so severe, with rumors about Facebook engineers being locked out of buildings and having to get driven to data centers to repair the damage. The second phase of the failure withdrew BGP advertisements, which we saw are necessary to cross boundaries between ISP networks and a private network. Before, one could still be routed to a Facebook Edge server. After the BGP withdrawal, all of Facebook completely vanished from the picture of the internet, with no way to be routed in. This exercise glimpses the complexities of networking in the modern era. We see how even our most standardized and informative maps can require significant clarification, with changes to how the internet is used. Maps are informed by our social and cultural expectations of the internet, shaped by how we experience it, and affecting how we use it in turn. To analyze popular understandings of the internet, especially by the next generation of its users, we now turn to maps of the internet created not by experts, but by quite the opposite, children. There's a lot of anecdotal concerns about newer generations growing up with the internet while still having a flawed misunderstanding of it. Responding to this, a number of contemporary studies interview children or younger internet users, sometimes with drawing tasks, to acquire a colloquial sense of what the internet is and how it looks. Analyzing these can show us not just what misconceptions exist, but also what mental concepts might be misleading them. These are the realities of internet mapping in the present day. Barbara Rhee et al. In 2023 published an excellent meta-analysis of studies of children's understandings of the internet, analyzing 30 articles in English and German. Most of this group had intuitive, vague, or mistaken ideas about the internet. Following earlier points about the invisibility of its infrastructure, most children described the internet in terms of what it is used for, and did not show awareness of the role of multiple interconnected computers. In a 2021 Swiss paper by Luca Botturi, many children 8 to 10 depicted the internet in familiar terms, showing a variety of end devices without apparent connections, or imagined the internet to be a city with different buildings for different websites. In Barbary's meta-analysis, only very few children understood that the internet is a distributed system with multiple computers. The internet was often misattributed to being stored in their device or being from satellites. One view that is quite common but derided is that of the internet as a page of apps. In Botturi's sample, over half of children drew such a picture. It's understandable why this makes more sophisticated internet users wary. It shows no comprehension of any technical aspect of the internet and only how one experiences it in literal terms. This is not a new phenomenon. In the Barbary meta-analysis, depicting the internet through the activity one performs on it rather than its actual structure has persisted for over 20 years. However, even recognizing the limitations of this view, I do not think it is cause for doomsaying. First, everyday use may not be so impaired. In a study with 21 French children, Dine and Kitajima found that children who could draw a picture showing distinct pieces of computer hardware were on average only slightly less efficient at completing a simple internet research task than children who depicted the internet as just a web page. In fact, the much stronger factor was age. Children aged 13 to 14 were much quicker at the task, regardless of their mental model for the internet, suggesting that cognitive development with age and experience seemed more significant. Second, I think people read these images as pure mimicry with no active processing. Researching this video made me realize these pictures are similar to the maps that Berners-Lee produced at CERN for his hypertext layout for information. The priority is on showing intuitive organization and navigation between content, not underlying network internals. These drawings indicate that children have working comprehension of an abstract information organization and retrieval tool, which is not to be underestimated. Therefore, I think it's important to look for opportunities. It's not just the newest generation of kids who are used to smartphones that have mistaken beliefs about the internet. Studies of American undergraduates from 2008 to novice Czech computer science teachers reveals many of the same schemas and misunderstandings as those we associate with kids. Vague understandings of the internet's structure and where servers are located are widespread. This does not have to be so. In one of the only analyses of how conceptions of the internet can change, Bettina Waldvogel in 2019 had Swiss children draw the internet before and after watching just a 6-minute educational video about the internet. The pictures drawn after viewing the video are honestly still pretty confused, but show a much stronger foundation for comprehension. Furthermore, students on average were able to produce pictures that included routers, servers, and interconnected cables a month after viewing the video, a testament to our incredible capacity to learn. No misunderstanding is set in stone, and the right visualization or map can help. How do you map the internet? As with all maps, it's not just a matter of putting line to paper. Tackling the task or even viewing another's map instantly puts one into a decades-long and still ongoing conversation of how we understand the internet, what we use it for, and how we build it. Not just the wires and cables, but the protocols, the content, and the communities that lie on top of it. This video has been a survey, a whirlwind tour of how different people have pictured the internet or imagined it to be. The answer is that there's no definitive map, only approaches that are better or worse for a given task or context. Whether you're trying to situate the next node of ARPANET, attempting to sell undersea cables, trying to comprehend the nature of internet availability and censorship, making an artistic representation of internet subcultures, or just trying to teach someone a little bit more about where the images on their computer come from, a different map will serve your purpose. Hopefully, through this video, this linear map of maps, you've gained some understanding to help you find the map you need.